Welcome to the next lesson in the First Aid, CPR, and AED unit. In this lesson, we will talk about effective skills for administering adult and child CPR for a person experiencing a heart attack or cardiac arrest. CPR is an important skill to know because heart disease and cardiac arrests are an increasing problem in our country. Heart disease is the number one killer of Americans, and every year in the U.S., about 350,000 cardiac arrests happen outside of the hospital. In fact, 4 out of 5 cardiac arrests happen in the home, and you're most likely to do CPR on someone at home. So you can save a life. Your response in administering CPR could mean that someone survives. If you perform CPR within the first few minutes of a cardiac arrest, you double or triple that person's chances of survival. But remember, cardiac arrest and heart attacks are not the same. Cardiac arrest is when someone's heart suddenly and unexpectedly, often without prior symptoms, stops beating. A person in cardiac arrest is unconscious and not breathing normally. These are the typical signs of someone experiencing cardiac arrest. On the flip side, a heart attack is a blockage of blood flow to a portion of the heart that may damage an area of the heart muscle. So instead of being an electrical problem, it is very much a plumbing problem. A person having a heart attack is typically conscious and often experiences certain symptoms like tightness in the chest or shortness of breath. Although, again, it is important to know that a heart attack can trigger a cardiac arrest. So even though we want to help that person rest in a comfortable position, loosen any tight clothing, we do want to continue to monitor them and be ready to perform CPR or use an AED because cardiac arrest can result from that heart attack they're experiencing. Signs and symptoms of a heart attack include pressure or tightness in the chest, pain in the chest, back, jaw, or other areas of the upper body that lasts more than a few minutes or goes away and comes back, shortness of breath, difficulty breathing, sweating, nausea, upset stomach, and weakness. And remember, individuals can experience those heart attack signs and symptoms differently. Even if they've had a heart attack before, they may not experience those same signs and symptoms if they have a second heart attack. In addition, males often have these classic signs and symptoms of heart attacks, like chest pain that radiates down one arm, whereas females often have more subtle signs, like chest pain or discomfort that is milder or accompanied by more general signs and symptoms like shortness of breath, nausea and vomiting, extreme fatigue and dizziness or lightheadedness that often are non-specific in general, so they don't get help for them right away. They often experience them for hours, days, or even weeks leading up to that heart attack. And lastly, those signs and symptoms might be subtler in people with certain medical conditions like diabetes. No matter how someone is responding or experiencing those signs and symptoms of a heart attack, it's important to call 911 immediately. Someone in cardiac arrest needs immediate CPR and an AED if available. An AED helps to deliver a shock to the heart to help it enter back into a normal beating rhythm. Even if you don't have an AED, you still need to do CPR. CPR is critical in preserving the brain and vital organs until EMS providers arrive to do defibrillation. While CPR alone is unlikely to restart the heart, it will give a person a window of opportunity to be brought back to life without brain damage. The brain can go about 4 minutes without oxygen before permanent damage occurs. So if we can perform CPR on someone and help to circulate that blood through their body so that they can circulate that oxygen to their brain, it can help prevent that permanent damage from occurring. Bystander response is critical with CPR and cardiac arrest. Why is it necessary for a bystander to respond to someone who is in cardiac arrest? How is the response different for someone who is having a heart attack? Bystander response is critical when responding to cardiac arrest because the victim is not capable of calling for help themselves. Someone who is in cardiac arrest is unconscious and their heart is not beating, so they will die within minutes if they do not receive immediate attention. The response is different with someone who is having a heart attack. Instead, you want to call 911 and stay with them because they are usually conscious and have them relax comfortably, but you should also be ready to perform CPR just in case they go into cardiac arrest. Having an AED ready just in case somebody goes into cardiac arrest as a result of their heart attack is also a good idea if there's one available. As I stated in my last lesson, the cardiac chain of survival is critical when responding to cardiac emergencies. The cardiac chain of survival consists of five actions that, when taken, increases a person's chance of surviving cardiac arrest. Each link in the chain depends on and is connected to the other links, and each minute that CPR and defibrillation are delayed reduces the chance of survival by 10%. As a trained lay responder, you are the first link in the cardiac chain of survival, and four out of every five cardiac arrests in the United States happen outside of the hospital. By you completing the first three links in the cardiac chain of survival, calling 911 and having that early access to care, performing early CPR and early defibrillation, responders can make the difference between life and death for a person in cardiac arrest. In an emergency situation, every second counts in saving a life. However, not everyone responds, as only 46% to 68% of people in cardiac arrest get CPR from bystander. Why do some people hesitate to respond in an emergency situation? How many reasons can you come up with for why some people may hesitate or fail to respond to emergencies? When responding to emergencies, we do need to follow the check, call, care protocol in order to respond effectively. The first step we need to take is to check the scene around you. We need to make sure the scene is safe before we enter it to help someone who needs care. We need to figure out what happened and what might have caused injuries to the victim. How many people are involved? Do we need to give care to more than one person? What's going on with that person? Are they having severe bleeding? Are they going into shock? Are they in cardiac arrest? Is there anyone else who can also help to give emergency care or even just to call 911? And we need to check that person for responsiveness and breathing. Tapping their shoulder and shouting, "Are you okay?" to check for consciousness. Performing a quick head-to-toe exam to look for and control any severe bleeding. And also looking for any medical identification tags, bracelets, or necklaces which may indicate a person's condition. We want to look for chest rise and fall for no more than 10 seconds for breathing. If that victim is responsive, we can introduce ourselves and get consent to help. Remember, we do have to get consent from a conscious person before we give care, and they have the right to deny any care we want to give. For a child, we need to ask permission from a parent or guardian. If that victim is unresponsive, we can assume consent is implied and provide help to the victim immediately. Step two is calling 911 or the local emergency number for any life-threatening emergencies. Again, if there are other people at the scene, ask them to call the help for you so you can focus all of your attention on giving care to that individual. If you are by yourself, call 911 before you start CPR or get an AED machine. And step three is giving care. Give care to that individual until EMS personnel arrive. Do not abandon that victim. Monitor the person's breathing and consciousness and be prepared to act accordingly if they stop breathing or become unconscious. Help the person rest in the most comfortable position. Keep that person from getting chilled or overheated, and reassure that person, giving any specific care that is needed. Now we need to talk about hands-only CPR, which is one way to respond to a cardiac emergency. Here's a short video that overviews hands-only CPR. Hands-only CPR is recommended for adult patients since the most important part of CPR is doing high-quality chest compressions. CPR also has roughly the same survival rate with or without rescue breathing. By performing hands-only CPR, it gives someone in cardiac arrest a window of opportunity for being brought back to life without brain damage. In this video, Jackal Sims will demonstrate how to perform hands-only CPR. There are six specific steps for adult hands-only CPR. Step one is checking if the scene is safe. Step two involves tapping and shouting, "Are you okay?" to check for victim responsiveness. Yell for help if no response is given. In other words, yell for help if someone is unconscious. Step three, if someone is there, so another bystander, tell them to call 911 and get an AED. If you are alone, call 911, leave it on speaker, and get an AED if it is nearby. Step four, begin compressions within 10 seconds of checking the individual for breathing and responsiveness. Complete these compressions at a rate of 100 to 120 compressions per minute. This is the same beat you can find in the song Staying Alive, I Will Survive, or my personal favorite, Beyoncé's Crazy in Love. Step five, if an AED is available, turn it on and follow the directions. We'll learn how to use an AED in our next lesson. And lastly, step six, continue performing the compressions until EMS personnel arrives. If another responder is available, take turns giving compressions every 2 minutes, which is 5 cycles of CPR, spending no more than 10 seconds switching roles. There are several factors that can increase a patient's survival rate when performing hands-only CPR. Starting those compressions within 10 seconds of collapse, getting early defibrillation, so getting an AED or EMS personnel there as soon as possible to defibrillate, performing high-quality chest compressions, and no more than 10 seconds of interruption between compressions. A bystander's quick reaction can make the difference between life and death. When delivering hands-only CPR, we want to make sure we are giving high-quality compressions. These compressions should be at a rate of at least 100 compressions per minute, but not faster than 120 compressions per minute. And again, this is the same beat as Staying Alive by the Bee Gees, I Will Survive by Gloria Gaynor, or Crazy in Love by Beyoncé. They should also be at a depth of at least 2 inches for adults and children. We need to make sure we allow for the chest to completely recoil or come all the way back up between compressions before we push down again. And remember, don't interrupt those compressions for more than 10 seconds. If you find the patient who has collapsed and is not responding but is breathing, roll them into the recovery position if you don't suspect a head or neck injury. Then call 911 and monitor their breathing. While similar to adult CPR, child CPR does have some differences. This video will show a visual representation of how to perform CPR on a child. There are several differences between adult CPR and child CPR. And when we talk about child CPR, this is a child that is generally between 1 year old and puberty, which is typically around 12 years of age. One difference is that you may use one or two hands to give compressions, although compression depth is the same as adult, which is about 2 inches. In addition, hands-only CPR is not recommended for children. That means a person does need to give 2 rescue breaths over the period of 10 seconds. If you are alone or not near a phone, do about 2 minutes or 5 cycles of CPR before actually calling 911. The steps of performing child CPR are as follows. Step one, check that the scene is safe. Step two, tap and shout, "Are you okay?" for responsiveness and breathing. Yell for help if there is no response. Step three, if someone is there, tell them to call 911 and get an AED. If you are by yourself and not near a phone, do 5 cycles of CPR before stopping to call 911. Step four, we need to open the airway. To do this, you need to tilt the head back and lift the chin. Step five is all about the rescue breath. To do this, pinch the nose and give 2 breaths so the chest rises. If the chest does not rise on the first breath, readjust the head, so retilt the head and lift the chin, and give a second breath. Step six, if unresponsive to rescue breaths, begin CPR. So if someone doesn't start breathing after those 2 rescue breaths, start your compressions. Begin with 30 compressions within 10 seconds, followed by 2 rescue breaths. If an AED is available, turn it on and follow the directions. The last step, or step 8, is to continue with the CPR cycle until EMS arrives or if you see obvious signs of life like breathing. If another responder is available, take turns giving compressions and breaths every 2 minutes or every 5 cycles of CPR, spending no more than 10 seconds switching roles. This concludes the adult and child CPR training. Please go to the First Aid, CPR, and AED folder and take the quiz.